Good morning.
Seek me out. How could I be lost when you have called me found? You chase me down. You seek me out. How could I be lost when you have called me found? Like a tidal wave crashing over.
Praise God. Give me a hand this morning like you really mean it. Yeah. Praise God. Welcome to Church on the Move. We're so happy to have you here with us today. Our online watchers, if you can hear me and see me right now, praise God. Because we've been working on a new system. I spent quite a bit of time this week on it. So as we move forward with our service, here's what I'd like you to do. I need you to, in the comment section, let me know what device you're listening on, whether it's your tablet, your phone, your TV, and how it's coming through, so that I can begin to make some twists and some adjustments. We've been moving on with a new system that's going to allow us to expand into the future and join the 2000s, right? Amen? So your comments and your feedback are very helpful. If you have a comment or feedback on my sermon, do not post it. I don't really care about that part, but I do want to know how the sound and everything's coming through. Amen. And we have somebody new we'd like to welcome here with us today. Josh and Amber Black have a new little baby back there. Beautiful. Estella and Grace Black. Congratulations, guys. What a beautiful, beautiful baby. He was born January 6th, and we're so happy to have her as part of the Church on the Move family. I got the Journey students are here with us today. I saw their fearless leader just walked in. I saw him. So happy to have you guys. They work hard and do a lot of amazing work out at Camp Bighorn. They also went into the middle of nowhere into the desert in eastern Oregon with Adam for a long period of time. So that alone right there deserves your prayers for them. Amen. They were crazy enough to do something like that. So welcome, everyone. I'm excited about today. Anytime that we have the chance to be in the house of God, we should be excited about being here. Did anybody else notice that it was a rather windy day the other day? And I tell you what, on our hill, it's normally windy. It was cooking. It woke me up early in the morning, and I thought to myself, well, that's kind of nice. I'm in here. I'm tucked away. It's a little windy outside. I like this. I like feeling secure. And about that time, a shingle flew by and smacked against my sliding glass door. Woke me right up. So spent a little time on my roof, but wow, what an amazing thing. And that's not even that powerful, but it just gives you a small glimpse into just how little we are in comparison to our God. Amen? Amen. Our offering, still in the buckets in the back, as well as the drop location in the foyer. Jonathan's going to give you a little bit more information about Penny March and what we're going to do as far as missions coming up very soon. God has always supplied our needs and according to what he desires us to do and what his will is, and we have seen that he has not let up on that through this entire situation through 2020 and as we move into the new year. So I'm just going to pray right now. We're not going to pass anything out, but I'm going to pray over offering because sometimes we skip that in the busyness of what we do and the new patterns that we've gotten into. Heavenly Father, I praise and glorify your name. Father God, I thank you for the provision that you give us, both in our personal lives, Father, and the provision you give us at this church, Father God, to do your work, to do your will, to carry out your mission and your vision. Father, I ask that you bless the gift and giver alike, Father God. I ask that you encourage us to use wisdom, encourage us to follow your light, Father God, to follow your plan for this church and for this community, that we may be a light in a dark place. And Father, I just ask that you bless it. In your precious name we pray. Amen. Amen. I'm going to ask Jonathan if he would come up and give us our announcements. Now, Jonathan, I don't believe I announced this last week. So, Jonathan, when he started here, said, hey, we got to get you certified. We got to get you certification for ministry. And it's through the Assemblies of God, and you got to take some college courses, and we got to get you started on that. And so he started, and then, you know, things, life would happen, and then we kind of come back to it, but he was persistent, and he kept with it. And then he married Hannah, which put it into overdrive. Yeah, yeah. Guys, who knows when you get married and your wife can get in behind and say, dude, you need to put the remote down and do your work. So once we got Hannah in there, it has accelerated, but he has done the work, he has done the time, and he'll be going up to our connection conference with the district up in Butte here in a couple weeks, and we'll receive his credentialing, and he passed all the tests, and they interviewed him and grilled him, and they even asked me what he was like. And even through all that, they still did it. So, amen. Congratulations, Sean.
The Connection Conference is up in Butte, and it's we're going to be staying in a hotel right next door to the Rib and Chop House. So that is a sacrifice we are willing to make for this church. Good morning, Church on the Move. It's good to see all the faces in here today. This is a good day. All right, moving right along. BGMC and our Family First Sundays will be starting again. That is exciting. It's going to officially restart on the first Sunday of February. So all the loose change you've been collecting over quarantine and during our downtime, it's time to break it out. Together, all of us together, we can solve the national change shortage. I believe that. But for real, we are excited because family is one of our values, and it's extremely important to us. If you're new here within the last couple of months, we do a penny drive where the boys and the girls in our kids ministry, they bring pennies and change, and the boys come and they put their change in the boys' bucket, and the girls put their change in the girls' bucket, and then we bring out this big scale, and we weigh them. And it's kind of a fun way to take the missions offering, and whoever's the heaviest wins, and we kind of tally that up through the year, and we're just, you know, congratulations if you won. And it's really fun for the kids. So then after that, the kids' ministry stays in here, and they hangs out with their parents and for the entirety of the worship portion of the service, and then they get dismissed to go back down to the classroom. So it's a really fun way to come and incorporate the kids' ministry and just bring a new level of energy in during worship. And we kind of need that energy sometimes. So we're excited for that. That's going to be the first Sunday in February. So let's just get ready for that just boost of energy, because sometimes we have to prepare for energy, right? So this is your heads up. Okay, so for my next announcement, he's probably really going to hate this, but I wanted to give a shout out to Pastor Chuck, because he has, and this isn't because he just said nice things about me. I had it on the paper. He has worked so hard for this church, and he does things that we never see happen. Like, every day, every week, he goes to battle for us, and he does spiritual warfare. He puts out fires all around, and it can be very unnoticed, and it can go very unappreciated. So if you see him around, like in the coffee shop or something, could you just tell him thank you? Because I was a youth kid in his youth ministry when he was a youth pastor. So I've seen the growth that has happened in the last 4 years. And it's a big deal. But seriously, the growth that's happened in Pastor Chuck, the growth that's happened in this church, the growth that's happened in myself since I've come on in the staff of this church is just, it's crazy. It's stuff that I've never thought would happen, and he's just been very dedicated, and he's worked very hard, put blood, sweat, and tears into this place, and he's just really stepped in and allowed God to move in his life and to guide his steps, and it's been very apparent that he's allowed God to take the lead. So let's just give it up for Pastor Chuck. We love you, Pastor Chuck. Okay, moving on. In between the Old and the New Testament, before Jesus was on scene, Israel had become politically dominated by the Roman Empire. The Jewish people had been dominated for a large chunk of their existence, and they were pretty fed up with it, which is pretty understandable. But I see this as a comparison to things in our own lives. We get our minds dominated by the internet, Netflix, our cell phones, gossip, drama, all sorts of things can take over if we're not careful. And it's the same with our bodies. If we don't monitor the things that we eat, guilty, or drink, or inhale, or ingest, we're allowing Mountain Dew and Marlboro to take control of our bodies. And while that's not cool, and I really hate that for us, Pepsi, Marlboro, Bud Light, even McDonald's, they're not our true enemies. Just as the Romans were not the true enemies of the Jewish people, the people of Israel, after lifetimes of oppression, got a little twisted and began to believe that the prophesied Messiah would come to deliver them from the vile clutches of their Roman captors. And they believed that the Messiah would come as a powerful military leader that would allow Israel to rise up and take her place as one of Earth's greatest world powers. So when Jesus came on scene and said, "If someone slaps you, turn the other cheek also," they crucified him. So my question for you today is, are you allowing the things that you come up against in your life to twist your expectation of Jesus into something that he isn't? Because Jesus is the unchanging truth, and if he didn't change his messianic ways for the people of Israel all those years ago, he isn't going to change to save us from our bad decisions. There's a real enemy out there, and that enemy wants you distracted so that he can claim your life, and that is the battle that Christ fought, and that is the battle that we need to be fighting as well. So one last time, don't allow the temporary physical battles of this life change your expectations of Christ. Read his word, find out who he says that he is, and expect him to never change.
Amen, that was good. And there wasn't one quote in there from Gandalf or Yoda, I don't think. Yeah. Amen, great job. Well, you notice my son Reed is with us here today. Yeah. So, and I could hear him during worship. He was looking at Darren, and he says, "Bud, it's pretty wild. Bud, it's pretty wild." So he may need to sit more towards the back. I don't know, but you will probably hear him now and again throughout this message. But I'm happy to have him here, as well as happy to have all my kids here. But this little guy has brought amazing joy into our life, yes, and destruction as well. So if he is headed at you with a sharp object, remove yourself immediately. Don't assume you can take him. I've made that mistake before. Yes. We're going to move into worship now, and worship is such an amazing time, such an amazing opportunity. You've done the first step of what my sermon is titled today, and that's show up. And we're going to talk about one of my favorite Bible characters, Moses. Now, I cannot preach about Moses without seeing Charlton Heston in my head. But we're going to talk about Moses because he was an amazing man, and he was an amazing man of character who just kept showing up. And it's something we have to do in life as Christians, as believers, is keep showing up. Keep showing up for what God is requiring and asking of us in our life. And then we will see blessings. And we will see amazing things happen. So we have an opportunity to worship. And I pulled a scripture out that I want to read real quick. It's Psalms 34, verses 1 through 5. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul makes its boast in the Lord. Let the humble hear and be glad. Magnify the Lord with me and let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord and he answered me and delivered me from all my fears. Those who look to him are radiant and their faces shall never be ashamed. Never be ashamed. We serve an amazing God. In those lean times, in those days where you feel down, in those times where you're not sure of yourself, he's always right there by your side. We can depend on him, we can count on him, and he deserves all our praise and worship 24/7. But here we are corporately, as a group, as a church, as a family, with the opportunity to lift him in praise and worship, to lift him in song. So let's do that with everything you have, and let's see a radiant glow that we can give to him. Amen.
Child of God, yes I am.
forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am.
I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am who you say I am. I am who you say I am. The sun sets free, oh, it's free indeed. I'm a child of God, yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God, yes, I am.
Darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here, touching every heart. I worship you. Turning lives around, I worship you, I worship you. You are here, bending every heart, I worship you.
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the dark.
You never stop working. You never stop. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop. You never stop working. You never stop. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop. Moved by the sound of his voice, the seas that are shaken and stirred can be calmed and broken from my regard. Through it all, my eyes are on you. Through it all. In front of me will be thrown into the midst of the sea. Through it all, through it all, my eyes are on you. Through it all, through it all, it is well. Through it all, through it all. It is well, so let come.
Heavenly Father, we praise and we glorify your name, Father God. We lift you up to where you belong, higher than any other, Father, exalted, exalting the name of Jesus. Father, we praise you. Father God, we honor you. Father, we thank you for all that you've done for us, for all that you've given us, for your sacrifice, Father. And it is well in our souls. Father God, it is well because it is your will. It is well because you have orchestrated it, Father God. It is well because you are in charge and you are in control, and no man or governing body can take that away. You are in charge. Father, we praise you, we glorify you, we honor you. And Father God, I ask right now for those of us that may be a little fearful right now, Father, for those of us who may have suffered through this last year, Father God, whether it be relationships, whether it be finances, whatever the trouble may be, Father God, whatever the enemy has attempted to steal, Father God, we know that you will return tenfold. Father God, that you will go ahead of us and make the crooked places straight. Father God, that you will go and retrieve what the enemy has come into our camp to gather. You will retrieve it. You will replace it. You will give it back to us in a way that we never saw coming. Father, I pray that purpose and destiny be released in these people, Father God, that ministries they thought had been forgotten be resurrected, Father, that the feeling of waking up optimistic and going after and chasing you would be revived within us, that we would wake up focused on coming after you, coming after your will for our lives. Thank you, Jesus. Find rest in him. Find peace in him. Give it all up to him today. If you've got something going on in your life and you are struggling and you're in a tug of war with God, let go. Let him have control. Let him guide you and move you forward. Father, I praise and glorify your name. And Father God, I ask as always, the word that you've given me, Father, let these be your words, not mine. Let them to be said in your tone and not mine. Father, you're in complete control. This is your church. This is your pulpit. This is your community. These are your people. Father, I just ask that you take complete control, Father God, and we give you free reign. Speak to us. Show us and grow us. Father, we will give you all the praise and the glory and the honor. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
God gave me a word this morning, and it's been echoed ever since that last song. It's just been echoed, so I want to share it. There's people here that are tired. There's people here that are frustrated. We're all fighting a battle, each and every one of us. I'm one of those people that I don't know. I don't know my next step. But God gave me a verse, and I want to say it's Matthew 11:28. I'm pretty sure it's what it is. It says, come to me, all who are heavy and weary laden, and I will give you rest. I looked up the Hebrew words for those, and I'm not even going to try to pronounce them, but the meaning of of it was the heavy laden. It said spiritual anxiety. I don't know about you guys, but there's definitely times in my life I have spiritual anxiety and physical anxiety. I get tired, I get frustrated, I don't see a light at the end of the tunnel. It just seems like sometimes I feel like it's like a monotonous direction that I'm walking, and I know I'm not the only one out here. Then I looked at the word rest, and this word just meant so much to me. The meaning of rest in that verse was refresh. God will refresh you no matter where you're at, no matter what battle you're walking in, no matter the journey God has you on. He has you there for a specific purpose right now. We don't always understand why. We don't know what it is. But if you will continue to trust him and be obedient to him and remain in his presence, he will bring refreshment in your life. He will fill you up in a way that nothing else can. So whatever you do, do not let go of him.
Amen. He's right. I've shared with you about feeling tired, about feeling weary, about feeling needing to be refreshed. He's correct. All those things are found within our Lord and Savior. The sermon today is entitled Show Up. Now, this is based on anybody in here sports fans. You like sports. Okay? Anybody like baseball? Okay, I like baseball. I like baseball history. I used to be able to watch an entire game, and now there's no way I can, so I just catch the highlights. But this happened back in 1995, and this was brought back to my memory and connected to Moses. So on September 6, 1995, I was 21 years old, and I was witnessing baseball history. I sat in my living room and marveled at a very simple thing, showing up. Cal Ripken Jr. broke one of baseball's most unbreakable records that night, topping Lou Gehrig's 2,130 consecutive game streak, which had stood for 56 years. Now, he went on to play 501 more games and set the record at a seemingly unreachable 2,632 consecutive games. I remember watching that. I remember they had the numbers up in the outfield. They stopped the game. He's a very humble individual. They put him out there so that he could do the wave. It wasn't for hits. It wasn't for runs. It was for showing up. It was for showing up. But it was one of the most amazing atmospheres. 2,632 straight games. It wasn't his shoes, it wasn't his glove, his bat, or his salary that caused this record. It just came down to one thing. He showed up. So today we're going to talk about someone else who had this quality, and that was Moses. Now, I don't think they had baseball back in the day of Moses. Maybe they had something similar. I don't know. Don't know if he was a good player. But I know one thing about Moses. He showed up. When it came to God and the things of God, he showed up. Now, you may be thinking, oh, he's telling us we got to get to church every week. That's not where this is going. Exodus chapter 34, verses 1 through 6. The Lord said to Moses, "Cut for yourself two tablets of stone like the first. And I will write on the tablets the words that were on the first tablets, which you broke. Be ready by the morning, and come up in the morning to Mount Sinai, and present yourself there to me on the top of the mountain. No one shall come up with you, and let no one be seen throughout all the mountain. Let no flocks or herds gaze opposite that mountain." So Moses cut two tablets of stone like the first, and he rose early in the morning and went up to Mount Sinai, as the Lord had commanded him. And he took in his hand two tablets of stone. The Lord descended in the cloud and stood with him there and proclaimed the name of the Lord. The Lord passed before him and proclaimed, the Lord, a God merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness. There are so many things that we can learn from the story of Moses and his life. But in this short section of Scripture, we're going to focus on one of his strongest character traits, that he showed up. Now that sounds very simple, but it's far from it, because showing up involves a few other things that we're going to look at. The very first thing in Moses' life that it required was listening when we review this passage of Scripture. Everybody hear that? Listening. The first is listening. In verse 2, it says, be ready by the morning and come up in the morning to Mount Sinai and present yourself there to me on the top of the mountain. Now, remember, Moses had already done this, and things didn't work out so well with the first set of tablets. And sometimes, very much in the same way, we don't want to listen to God's instruction because of past failures. We can't get a one-and-done attitude when it comes to moving on God's behalf. Well, I tried that, but it didn't work. The last time I forgave someone, they burned me. The last time I really loved someone, they left me. The last time I was involved in church, people treated me badly. But the thing we got to grab out of this is, your negative experience never will change God's positive influence. Sometimes we go into situations and we think, I'm never going to do that again because I was once hurt. The problem is we're finding our value in who hurt us, not our value in the one who called us. People should not have the ability to hurt us to the point where we will not respond to God's call on our life. The people had hurt Moses. They had taken for granted what he was doing, how he was putting himself out there. I doubt it was an easy task to carve out a couple tablets back in that day. He gave of himself. He humbled himself. And in return, he got a rebellion against God. And now God is saying, I want you to go back and I want you to do this process yet again. The thing with Moses is, which is different than some of us sometimes, is he showed up. He didn't look on his past failure. He didn't look at how the children of Israel had treated him in that situation. He looked at the fact that his God was asking something of him, and that goes before anything else. His loyalty, his commitment, and his ability to show up. We often in this world, in this society today, let negative experiences change God's positive influence. Galatians chapter 6, verse 9, let us not grow weary of doing good, for in due season we will reap if we do not give up. If we do not give up. There is a problem going on today in our churches and in our society that says giving up and being mediocre is okay. Now, are we ever going to reach the pinnacle? Are you ever going to be exactly like Jesus on this earth? No, but that should not stop you from the pursuit of such. It should not stop you from the pursuit. We've gotten to where I've been guilty of this in the past in my life. Well, it didn't work. I stuck myself out there. I tried, but it didn't happen. So now I'm going to sit in the corner and I'm going to have a pity party about how it all turned out. And when you do that, one thing arises above all. Somebody has to be guilty of your emotions. Somebody has to take the fall for your inabilities. Somebody's got to be at fault. Does anybody see that leaking into our society today on a massive scale? Whatever I do is a reaction to what somebody else made me do. That's not how it works. Everything we do should be a reaction to what God has asked us to do. Our lives would be so much more simple if we could just hang on to that, not question what God's going to do, not take 2 years to carve out the tablets. Not wonder if maybe that was God's voice or maybe it wasn't. But to be like Moses and just say, you know what? I hear you. I'm listening. And I'm going to show up. Luke chapter 11, verse 28 says, but he said, blessed rather are those who hear the word of God and keep it. True blessedness, according to Jesus, is found in obedience to God's word. Not just reading it, not just memorizing it, not just knowing it, but being obedient to his word and to his call. Moses pushed past his disappointments, listened to God's request of him. And now came the even more difficult part, the one that so many of us are guilty of missing. He had to take action on those words. Verse 4, so Moses cut two tablets of stone like the first, and he rose early in the morning and went up out of Mount Sinai, as the Lord had commanded him, and took in his hand two tablets of stone. He just did what God requested of him. He took action. James chapter 1, 22 through 25. But be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. For if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man who looks intently at his natural face in a mirror. For he looks at himself and goes away and at once forgets what he was like. But the one who looks into the perfect law, the law of liberty, and perseveres, being no hearer who forgets, but a doer who acts, he will be blessed in his doing. We have to receive God's call and his word as doers and not hearers. To take comfort in the fact you have heard God's word when you haven't done it is to deceive yourself. To read God's word, to hear his call upon your life and decide that's who you are without carrying out the action is deceiving yourself. See, if Moses says, I've already went up there, I've already carved out the tablets, I've already taken care of the Ten Commandments, I've already led him out of Egypt, I've already parted the Red Sea, I've already done all of these things, and now you want me to do it again, and he says, I refuse to, I'm comfortable where I'm at, I'm not going to pursue this any further. The story of Moses and the children of Israel looks very different, doesn't it? It's not the same Moses. It's not the same Ten Commandments. Everything gets tipped on its head if he doesn't become a doer and not just a hearer. And that's something we see a lot of. There are a lot of hearers. A lot of people who can memorize scripture. A lot of people who can teach us behind a microphone. A lot of people who can write studies. A lot of people that can do many, many great things. But they sit back and they are just actually not a doer of the word. The word loses power when there's no action behind it. To take comfort in the fact you have heard God's word when you haven't done it is to deceive yourself. Jesus used this same point to conclude his Sermon on the Mount. He said that the one who heard the word without doing it was like a man who built his house on the sand. But the one who heard God's word and did it was like a man whose house was built on a rock. The one who both heard and did God's word could withstand the inevitable storms of life and the judgment of eternity. The last part of that scripture, the one who both heard and did God's word could withstand the inevitable storms of life. It's not whether they might come. It's not whether if, it's when. You're going to have storms in your life. I didn't wake up the other morning prepared for the winds that were going to be pushing across my house. And as I ran and I scattered to try to get the things that were in other people's yards and over in the field to keep them from going any further, and the wind was pushing against me and I began to feel so small, and then shingles just started flying over my head. And I'm looking up at the shingles, and for every shingle that goes over my head, all I'm picturing is me on my knees with a hammer the next day. Every single one. But there was absolutely nothing I could do about it. I had no control over it whatsoever, but to just watch what was happening. It wasn't even that big of a storm, but it was powerful enough to begin to dismantle things in my life. Those days are going to come. You're going to wake up not expecting a storm. It is not on your radar. Nobody has told you about this. Nobody has warned you. There was no weather alert for your life. You're going to wake up one day and things are going to change. And as I look out here, I see many people in this church that I have watched when that has happened in their life. When just one day, when just one phone call, when just one diagnosis turns everything on its ear and life changes. And you got to be ready for it. Because if you are just a hearer of the word, you won't know what to do. You don't hear the word consistently for 30 years, and then on year 31, you need to act on it, and it just happens. If you've been sitting idle for 30 years, you've got a really rude awakening that's going to happen. We have to be doers of the word. We have to show up. Because during the storms of life, if you feel like everything is shifting beneath your feet, then we've got to ask ourselves, what is our foundation? Is it sand or is it rock? See, the words you proclaim don't make it rock. The stickers on your car don't make it rock. Your Facebook posts don't make it rock. You can put out a counterfeit faith. In fact, it's one of the favorite pastimes right now in our world. But counterfeit faith is not going to pay the bills when the storm comes. I had to check myself years ago. Am I a hearer? Is that all I am? Or am I a doer? Because there's a big, big difference. One of the phrases my dad used growing up when I would tell him about all my plans. Well, that sounds great, Chuck. You got the talking part done. You got the talking part done. Moses chose to show up. And this is the great part, because when he chose to show up, there was somebody waiting for him. And that was the unmistakable presence of God. In verse 5, the Lord descended in the cloud and stood with him there and proclaimed the name of the Lord. Now, this wasn't just some ordinary puffy cloud he had never seen before. This was a familiar cloud, the cloud of glory, known as Shekinah. A Hebrew name meaning one who dwells. This cloud was familiar to Moses because it covered Mount Sinai in Exodus 19. It went with Israel by day in Exodus 13. It stood at the tent of Moses in Exodus 33. It filled Solomon's temple with glory in 2 Chronicles. It overshadowed Mary at the conception of Jesus in Luke. It was present at the transfiguration of Jesus in Luke chapter 9, and it will be present at the return of Jesus. The cloud that descended, the cloud that sat down that allowed communication with Moses, that cloud, the presence of God, that's coming for us. Amen? The presence of God is going to descend once again and cover this earth 100%. Shekinah glory, the same that Moses saw, overshadowing Mary at the conception of Jesus. Think about that. Present at the transfiguration of Jesus. And it's going to be present at his return. Verse 6, the Lord passed before him and proclaimed, the Lord, a God merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness. What this scripture spoke to me, what this story of Moses spoke to me, is that if you show up, God's going to confirm who he is. If you show up, God will confirm who he is. We've got it a little backwards. We talk a lot and pray a lot in church about let the Spirit of God be in this place. We call the Spirit of God to show up for us. But if you show up, God will confirm who he is. You show up when he puts that calling on your life, he will confirm who he is. If you show up when you go his way instead of your way in that delicate situation, he will show you who he is. You want to know who God really is and what he can do in your life? Show up. Because people depend on your position in relation to God. When you accept the call in your life, it brings others face to face with him. Matthew chapter 9, 9 through 13. As Jesus passed on from there, he saw a man called Matthew sitting at the tax booth. And he said to him, "Follow me." And he rose and followed him. And as Jesus reclined at table in the house, behold, many tax collectors and sinners came and were reclining with Jesus and his disciples. Matthew's friends and former business associates wanted to see what the fuss was. What would cause Matthew to follow this man? And Jesus took advantage of Matthew's decision to also reach those whom he knew. Now, as I was studying this, this could have been hundreds of people that because Matthew decided to show up, to listen and to show up, hundreds of people followed to find out who this Jesus was. Just because Matthew decided to show up. So here's my question. If Matthew brought several hundred people to find out who Jesus was because he showed up in a real way, what if 100 people showed up because you showed up? Every single person in here, what does that look like when that's replicated in our society? I'm tired of seeing small groups of people, 3 to 5 people, making a huge effort to try to run a church, to try to run a ministry, to try to move things forward, while everybody else is content to sit. They want to be hearers, but they don't want to be doers. There's too much risk in that. Let the other people who are called do it. I've got news for you. You are called. The Great Commission was not set aside for certain pastors and for certain people throughout history. It was for every last one of us. Verse 11. And when the Pharisees saw this, they said to his disciples, "Why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners?" Ew. But when he heard it, he said, "Those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick. Go and learn what this means. I desire mercy and not sacrifice, for I came not to call the righteous, but sinners." The church needs to regroup and focus on its purpose. This building is not for those who are saved to have a warm seat, to listen to their music, and practice tradition. It is a hospital for the sick that promotes getting well and getting out. Getting well and getting out. Here's my problem. The church has often said is full of sick people, of course, because it's a hospital. But we have to be a hospital that is also a rehabilitation service. That when people come into the hospital to receive care, we have to begin to move them on and rehabilitate them so that they can leave the hospital and make a difference. We can't just come and sit for 20, 30 years in our own sickness because it's a place where the machines will keep us alive. It's a place that spiritual oxygen will be supplied long enough for us to live our life out. God called us to bring sick people into this place so that they might know Jesus, come in, and then move out. Be disciples of Christ, moving out and sharing the gospel, the Great Commission. The church has forgotten about the Great Commission. We've forgotten about the Great Commission because we get set in our ways, and it's easy to think, this is a good church, this is a good fit, and this is where I need to stay. And maybe that's what God has in mind. But if you're in here, you better be growing. You better be growing. And you better be sensitive and close enough to the Holy Spirit to understand that when His voice calls, you listen. And if he calls you to move on, and if he calls you to go out and be a missionary, if he calls you from your comfort to go out and join a journey program, if he calls you out of your comfort zone, you listen. Be a hearer, but then you better convert that to being a doer. Because without doers, we're all going to stay just the same. And I don't know about you, but I don't want to stay the same. I don't ever want to get in a mode where I feel like I'm a pretty good guy. I do some pretty good stuff. I see a lot of people around me that are a whole lot worse. So I'm just going to mail this in and drive this on down the road and retire someday. It's not what this is about. If I'd wanted to do that, I'd have stayed in banking. I'd have kept filling my retirement account. But that's not what this is about. The church needs to focus on its purpose, because we can't become like the Pharisees. See, they were like doctors who wanted to avoid all contact with sick people. What kind of doctor is that? I want to avoid all contact with sick people. You want to know what I convert that to in today's Christian walk, in today's Christian life? A doctor who wants to avoid all contact with sick people is usually somebody who develops a really nice, strong home church. Or I worship my God in the woods. Now, I'm not saying you can't. He's omnipresent. But what I'm saying is, you don't come to a church building because it's full of people, full of sick people, full of controversy, full of opinions that you don't want to hear. I'm that type of personality, believe it or not. If I wasn't pastoring this church, I don't know what church I would attend. God would have to speak very directly to me, because I want to get away oftentimes. I want to sit. I want to be a hearer, but I don't really want to be a doer. I want to be a doctor, but I don't want to be around sick people. I'll just stay where I'm at. I just God and I, that's the way he always intended it. Well, he accidentally made a few more people. See, of course, the Pharisees wished that sick people would become healthy, but they wouldn't risk getting infected themselves. As the worship team comes, he asks us to love sinners. He asks us to love the unlovable. He asks us to listen, just like Moses, and he asks us to show up. It's not always pretty, but in Romans 5:8, but God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. The ultimate sacrifice. He died upon that cross for us and for our sins. And I will never, ever be able to get over that fact. Because as long as I've been a follower of Christ, as many sermons as I've preached, it always comes back to the fact that he would find me that lovable. That he would love me that much to die for me. And for my sins. He showed up. And we have to show up. And you might find yourself saying, well, I'm just not sure I can do that. Because showing up has a price. And I'm just not sure I'm cut out for it. Jesus said, go to some very imperfect disciples. Peter was a rash and headstrong individual. John, who sometimes wished to call fire from heaven to destroy men, was another. Thomas, who had to put his finger into the print of the nails, or he wouldn't even believe him. Yet Jesus said to them, go. All power is given unto me, therefore go. He said to them, you are as good for my purpose as anybody else would be. There is no power in you, but then all power is in me. Therefore, go. What he's challenging us today, challenging us to do something that so many are not doing, Somebody's got to do it, guys. Somebody's got to quit being just a hearer and show up. Somebody's got to show up for these people. Somebody's got to show up for those that are hurting. Somebody's got to show up for those that are lost. Somebody has to stand in the gap just like he stood in the gap for us. Somebody's got to do it. Why not us? Why not? See, Cal Ripken Jr. didn't do something that amazing, but he did do something that rare. He had dedication, and he had character, and he showed up. Jesus showed up on the cross. When he calls you, when he speaks to you, when his word lays it out what the next step is, listen, act on it, and show up. Because if you show up, he'll meet you there. And the glory of God will move. Heavenly Father, I praise and glorify your name. Father God, I thank you for each and every person here today and the families that they represent. Father, I pray that you will stir our hearts, Father God, that you will be speaking to us each individually, that you will challenge us to show up. Challenge us to keep moving forward, even though sometimes we may be tired, even though sometimes it may seem like we can't go another step. Just keep pushing. Challenge us to show up, because we can do all things through you who strengthens us. Father, I ask that you be with us. There be peace in our day, peace within our families, Father, that you bring that joy that is unspeakable to so many. Father, that you hold us together as a family and as a community, and that we would always strive to show up so that your glory would appear. These altars are open for prayer. If you'd like to visit, please do so outside the foyer. But let's concentrate on one thing going out this week. Let's concentrate on showing up. He'll meet us there. Thank you, Jesus. Father, bless us, carry us, and help us to show up. In your sweet and precious name we pray. Amen.
Atmosphere is changing now. The Spirit of the Lord is here. The evidence is all around. But the Spirit of the Lord is here. The atmosphere changing now, for the Spirit of the Lord is here. The evidence is all around, for the Spirit of the Lord is here. Overflowing to
come.